I mean, you are really sweet.
Tell the truth.
Well, I want to talk to you today about the battle of ideas which have characterized the last at least 600 years of civilization. The battle of the ideas of the Renaissance versus the ideas of the Enlightenment. Now, when your enemy speaks about his intentions openly, and you know epistemologically that he's speaking the truth, you do better to listen to him. Now, 2 weeks ago, one of the persons who is the self-proclaimed spokesman of the oligarchical faction today, Lord Rees-Mogg, wrote in the London Times an interesting article in which he claimed that Samuel Huntington and his infamous Clash of Civilization thesis was completely wrong, namely where Samuel Huntington stated that the coming clash of civilization will be the West against Islam and the West against Christianity. Now, Rees-Mogg said that that will not be the conflict, but it will really be the old values against the new ones. The old values of Christianity, Islam, Confucianism, and that these would have more in common than the new values based on the new age, consumerism, Coca-Cola, cocaine consumption, and a culture in which people have moved to buy a moment of personal excitement. Go to vacation, go to the Caribbean, and that they would be enslaved by a craving for stimulation of the new age, drugs, sex, Hollywood, all the things Lynn has been talking about. And he said that the old Europe and the old United States would have to fear just as much as the old China and the old Islam. Well, I mean, look around. Look at the United States and Europe with the eyes of somebody living in a place like Sudan, or living in a place like poorer areas in Ibero-America. And, you know, if you look at our culture here, it is absolutely clear that from the standpoint of somebody who watches what is on the video, what is on the TV, this is a dying culture. People who like these talk shows, who like these idiotic soap operas, violence videos, I mean, this is a culture which, without any question, will be destroyed if people not change. It's the end phase of a dying culture. Now, the only way to understand what is the point we are at in human history is, as I said, not from day-to-day politics, not from last week to this week, but only if you situate what is happening today in 600 years of the fight of the Renaissance against the Enlightenment. And it is very important that you look at these two conceptions as being two completely different ideas of man, the universe, and society. And please, search in yourself where you are leaning to, which is the idea you think is the correct one about man and the universe. The Renaissance thinks about man as in the image of God, where each individual participates in the ongoing creation, process of creation through creative reason. It is a notion of man where man is conceived as limitless perfectible. The idea of man based on a tremendous cultural optimism, and where the highest ideal is to have a beauty of the soul, where the political expression is the sovereign nation state dedicated to the common good of the people, which can be realized only through scientific and technological progress, and where the idea of the universe is a necentropic idea. Now, on the other side, you have the ideas of the Enlightenment, man is basically evil, he's a beast. You have a mechanistic view of the thought process. Knowledge is not acquired through creative reason, but through sensuous experience. You have a mechanistic view of the universe. The universe is collapsing and more evil is in it than good. And you have a tremendous cultural pessimism and cynicism about your fellow man. Now, the problem is that the leading institutions of the West have been taken over by that second point of view. And as Lynn has stated yesterday, up to 30 years ago, there was a kind of back and forth, one time more sovereign nation state, the other time more oligarchical model. But there was a symbiotic coexistence of both forms. And the reason was that the nation state again and again proved basically a military superiority so that, you know, they could not completely eliminate technological progress up to the Cuban Missile Crisis and the whole process of detente. And as Lynn already explained yesterday, at that point, the power elites thought that the great wars would no longer be possible and that they could introduce the utopia of the post-industrial society and use the rock, drug, sex counterculture to stupefy the masses. Now, it is very important for those of you who have joined this movement only recently to look at the fact that Lynn founded this organization in the 60s very consciously against this paradigm shift. One of the first things we did was against the rock, drug, sex counterculture, which Lynn, as the only politician or individual at that point, recognized as being a mortal threat to mankind. And how many of you have recognized the danger of rock music? I don't think so. Maybe drugs and so forth, but popular music, for sure not. So from the beginning, this organization was fighting against the underlying axioms of that paradigm shift imposed by the oligarchical elite. Now, the problem is that once you go to hell, there is no final bottom place. And once you think that sensuous experience is the only method of knowing, then this sensuous experience needs to be stimulated. It's like the Marquis of Sade, who gets sexual satisfaction only through ever more degenerated degrees of perversion. And you know that this is so, you can easily see if you look some Hollywood movies of the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, last year, this year, yesterday, and you always think it's already beyond what is possible in terms of perversity, and they still top it, more violence and more sexual perversion. And you know, actually one can see that there is today, if you really look at it, there is an enslavement by people craving for a stimulation which shows you what is the final stage of the Enlightenment, namely Satanism. This was true in the 18th century as it is true today. And when I say Satanism, I don't mean it as a mere metaphor, it's reality. Now, this Satanism is also combined with a raving attack against the sovereign nation state. And Lynn already touched upon it yesterday, but I want to put your attention to it because in my mind it sticks out as one of the you know, the things which explain where the times are, which is this famous Dutroux case in Belgium, where, I mean, there was a pedophilia ring where many high-level politicians, even ministers of the Belgian government, the highest circles of NATO, were involved in sex orgies with children. And now the scandal has been going on for a while, and more corpses of the children who have been killed in these rituals have been found. Now, there were many mass demonstrations in Belgium against the cover-up by the same government which was involved in these orgies. And now something very interesting has happened, namely that the people who are protesting the destruction of the Belgian economy through Maastricht and the people who are protesting against this child abuse, even up to the point of murder, they have merged. And the parents of some of the murdered girls have emerged as the key leaders of this fight. For example, the father of two girls who have been killed is a steel worker who just last week called on the population to participate in a march for employment in Belgium to save one of the last Belgian steel mills, linking the fight against unemployment with the fight against this pedophilic diversion, saying that both are a reflection of the decadence of society. So the father said, the real problem is that the political world lacks the will and responsibility. They bow down in front of the financiers. Money is killing employment. Money is responsible for the deaths of Julie and Melissa. The financial logic is making abstractions of the value of the human beings. And then the mother, and you must imagine a mother who just lost two girls to people who killed them in the sexual orgy. She said, to understand that everything is linked, one has to pose the right questions. Look for the causes for grave injustice. Cease to be reasonable. Stop telling oneself that one cannot change the world. We have to become like children who ask questions all the time. We should not submit. It is true that in front of the world economy, one feels very small in one's own Belgian village, but one can no longer accept being a mere piece on the chessboard. Now, there is no place on this planet where the financial logic that does not care about the life of millions of people is more obvious than in Africa. There is right now a genocide going on by the Museveni clique, a puppet of the British oligarchy, and it couldn't be more obvious that the life of a million people in Zaire, Rwanda, Burundi means nothing to those forces who are now grabbing raw materials in the Great Lakes region. But if you look at the refugees, at the dying corpses, there is no question that if we do not respond to the challenge of Godfrey Benaissa yesterday, and that we turn the United States around on their policy to Africa, what you see there is just a pretaste of what will happen to all of the world. And that it is not a very long time ahead where the terra incognita will be as much in Europe and in the United States. Territory which will be controlled only by armed gangs of mercenary, and that we are looking towards poor hell. Africa, and if you look at what happens in Zaire in particular, and what is the danger for Sudan, it's also one of the best pretastes to see the urgent necessity to defend the nation state. Because the nation state is the only instrument which can defend the people against the tyrannic power of supranational institutions who are not accountable and who have any sense of being accountable to the common good of the people. So the nation state is something so precious, because what do you do against mercenaries? What do you do against IMF supranational dictators who force you to pay the debt even if you pay the flesh and the blood of your own citizen? There is only one institution mankind has generated in its entire development, and that is the sovereign nation state. Now, therefore, I want to explain to you, and please be patient because it goes back a little bit in history, how much effort it took to come to this notion. It's not self-evident. But unless we start from the axiom that each individual is made in the image of God, we can have no satisfactory order on this planet. The world does not belong to the forces who control the financial institutions. It belongs to the people on the basis of the sacredness of the human life. Today, the oligarchical forces are involved in a total attack on the nation state. But the people today live so much in the here and now, in the virtual reality of entertainment, in the sensuous excitement of the moment, that they do not recognize the danger this represents. I mean, we know it because right now we get calls, we get urgent appeals from parliamentarians in Latin America, from parliamentarians in Eastern Europe, from political leaders all over Africa, who say, what shall we do? The whole system is falling apart. Where? What is the way out? And it is very moving if you hear people who, you know, take the destiny of their nation serious, and they come to us and they ask these questions. Now, the nation state was a gigantic breakthrough of the Renaissance. Von der Heide, the author of the famous book, The Birth of the Nation State, wrote that the sovereign nation state and the community of peoples based on the law of nations is the most unique creation which the creative mind of the outgoing Middle Ages has left to man as a donation. And therefore, I want to take you now through the evolution of that sacred idea. Lynn has stressed many times that up to the creation of the nation state, in all of history, 95% of mankind was de facto living in slavery and in serf-like conditions. Now, that is actually true, because if you talk about history up to the Renaissance, you're talking about the history of the upper 5%, because the other people were uneducated, illiterate, living on the same soil like their generations before. They did not participate in anything. They were not noticed when they died. They are not accounted for. Their history has not been told. If you talk about history, you only talk about these 5%. In the 10th, 11th, and the 12th century, there were imperial power structure, but one can actually not talk about states at this point. You had power conglomerates, you had imperial structures. But in this period, in the 11th, 12th century, for the educated elite, you still had the idea of reductio ad unum, namely that all multitude must be based on unity, both politically as well as in respect to the church. At that point, it was the emperors of the Holy Roman Empire, of which Charlemagne was the first, as well as the papacy. Sure, you had the division into the East and the West. Also, the Salia emperors already had waged wars against Venice, the upcoming power of usury. But, you know, basically, people still had the idea that the political system had to be based on a unity. Then the next step was that the idea of independent kingdoms emerged. The first such independent kings were Henry II, the Plantagenet in England, 1154 to 1189, Louis the Ninth of France, Frederick Hohenstaufen in Sicily, Ferdinand of Spain, and his successor Alphonse the Wise. And at that point, they were involved in various struggles to debate on what level the jurisdiction and financial administration should be. The end result of these struggles was to determine who has the power over life and death, and that only on the level of the leadership of the state this could be, not on the level of baronies or more local authorities. There were severe inner battles if the leadership was with the king or with the landed aristocracy. The second notion which emerged in this period was the idea of sovereignty towards the exterior, that the ruler must be somebody who does not recognize anybody above himself on this planet. This was an important idea, that the sovereignty was nobody above yourself on this planet. Then a threefold demand emerged with the new developing state theory. First, not to recognize anybody higher on Earth. Second, to have the power of the emperor on your territory. Third, that it represents a complete unified community. These three issues emerged as the three great issues of the beginning of state theory, elements of what later became the notion of sovereignty. In the 13th century, the idea of the sovereign who does not recognize any power higher than himself becomes a political slogan. And all of a sudden, state theoreticians and political forces are talking about it. You have many books and treaties, memorandums, and that idea indeed represents the radical change from the 13th to the 14th century. And it turns out that that idea, not to recognize any power higher than yourself, turns out to be one of the most efficient ideas which has led to the evolution of the modern Europe. Ulrich von Strasbourg, who was a colleague and contemporary of Thomas of Aquinas, for the first time coined the notion that the state can be separated from the person of the sovereign, a new idea that a fatherland can exist separate from people. Now, the second important idea in the emerging notion of sovereignty was the idea of the equalization of the emperor and the king. And the first time this idea was conceived was by Ramon Llull at the end of the 13th century. Ramon Llull was a poet, a philosopher, and he had a beautiful vision that the head of the political order should be a persona comuna, a common person who would unify the interests of all people. But it was still one empire. Frederick II started the realization of this idea of the equalization of the emperor and the king for the first time in praxis by appealing to the reason of the princes to act according to solidarity and common interest. The idea of states who are acting sovereignly in equality together. Okay, let me now inject briefly another current which represented the seeds which later became the Enlightenment, because these things happened about at the same time. I have to point to the evil role of Roger Bacon, who was the first empiricist of the Middle Ages, not very far from Averroes, who bowdlerized the ideas of Aristotle and reintroduced Aristotle into Europe. Bacon introduced the notion of that there is a difference of human beings and a resulting difference of the legal order according to the geographical position and the position of the stars. Now, this will become extremely important later in Montesquieu and the social theory of the Enlightenment and in the anthropology today. That is the beginning of racism. So if people, the Afro-Americans, complain about dead white European males, I mean, here you have one, Roger Bacon. He should be declared dead because he is one of the fathers of racism. Now, in his tradition was the evil Wilhelm of Ockham, 1285 to 1347, who was born near London, studied in Oxford and Paris. And he became famous, among other things, for completely backing the Venetian aggression of Edward III of England against France, which became the Hundred Years' War. He was the key ally of Edward and the self-proclaimed emperor of the Holy Empire, Ludwig of Bavaria. And he was absolutely violent in his efforts to destroy both the papacy at a time when the Pope resided in Avignon and the schism existed. Ockham supported also Philip the Fair against Pope John the 22nd and Pope Bonifacius the 8th. Now, through Ockham, the idea emerged that there is no noble political structure, correct political structure, but it is always dependent on the circumstances of the time. And that became part of the state theory of enlightenment. It's no coincidence, obviously, that whatever Occam did throughout his whole life, it was always supported by Venice, and you can say he was a Venetian agent, which I cannot prove in terms of payroll, but he did never anything which was against Venetian interest. Now, it's a typical case where his theory was just the rationalization of the oligarchical aims of his time. Occam otherwise was a radical nominalist. The world for him was just a conglomerate of independent objects, knowable only through sense perception. And he was the inventor of the two truths, that there is theology on the one side and philosophy on the other side. And when you do that, well, then it leads to skepticism, because if you cannot know the laws of God through reason, then the only thing you are left with is blind faith and a non-intelligible universe. There is no purpose of creation because there is a limitless arbitrariness of God as the final cause for creation. God can do whatever he wants to. You are an object of his will, and there's nothing you can do. Now, Occam, therefore, is one of the evil minds leading to the destruction of cultural optimism by also eliminating responsibility, because if you don't know what is going on, then you know they have no point in taking your share of the load. Now, Dante was very critical of the corruption of Pope Boniface VIII. He put them among the Simonists in the eighth circle of the Inferno. But he was also against the French King Philip the Fair, who he called the evil of France, when Philip the Fair threw Boniface into jail. Now, in this period, in the 13th to 14th century, you had a seemingly unbridgeable contradiction between the sovereign state, or the state, who does not recognize anybody above, and the idea of an all-encompassing power of a unified Reich. And it's very interesting, because at that point you had many people writing about it, but eventually all the theoreticians and representatives of the intelligentsia in the 13th and 14th century simply gave up being resignated or failed. It was only Dantes de Monarchia, written in 1310, which resolved or began to resolve this conflict. And that constitutes the proof that it is the poets who shape history and not the kings or the politicians. Dante proceeded not from the facts of the given political reality, but he had a vision written out in the Monarchia Mundi, world monarchy, where he said you can have a world monarchy and a multitude of territorial states. As a poet, he had a prophetic vision of a golden future of mankind. And it is also interesting that it was Dante and Lull who for the first time had the idea that nobility is not a question of blood and possession of land, but the question of everybody becoming noble himself. A very important evolution. On the positive side, you had also Thomas of Aquinas, who died in 1274, who was very strong on the question of natural law. He said that there is a lex aeterna, a law, eternal laws given by God, which define the eternal order of the universe. And then you have lex naturalis, a natural law, with the participation of man in this divine thought, because man is capable of doing so because of reason, and man can recognize these laws. Therefore, the lex naturalis are directed against the bonum commune, the common good, and that he who is in charge of the common good then can make the leges humanae, the human laws. Therefore, according to Aquinas, there is a way of knowing the cohesion of natural law with human practice. Now this, again, is one of the most debated ideas. And if you go to any law school today and you say that natural law gives you a very concrete way of knowing what is the common good, all these professors will say, ah, this is absolutely untrue. Now, you should remember that it was Lind's discovery of the relative potential population density, which 7 centuries later gave us the first scientific proof. How do you define what is in the common good and what not? So, the latest after Lind's discovery, nobody can claim that they do not know this. But in the history of ideas leading to the present crisis, one has to also look at another Venetian propagandist, Marsilius of Padua, who in 1324 wrote Defensor Pacis, that's not him, who basically invented the teaching that all power proceeds directly from the people. Now, you have heard this. This is one of the holy cows of the Enlightenment and democracy today. This is supposedly the big thing about English democracy. Now, Marsilius also was an agent of the count at the court of Ludwig of Bavaria, and he also fought against the papacy. The idea that the people are the origin of the law, written in Defensor Pacis, has, however, the qualification that the capable part of the people should be involved in that. Now, for that, you have to know that in the 13th and the 14th century, the people had a completely different idea than today. It was a relatively small group of the upper class, the advisors of the emperor. So again, you have an idea where it was, the idea is only the democratic cover, the rationalization for oligarchical power. And that you have to learn to not take everything by face values, because these guys are tricky. They sometimes use very nice words to lure you into their belief, but you have to become smart. Now, all of this debate was interrupted by the dark age of the 14th century, where the collapse of the Bardi and Peruzzi banking houses were triggered, among other things, by the debt moratorium declared on the 6th May 1339 by Edward III, the one who launched the Hundred Years' War against France, because he went bankrupt over his war expenses. And basically, that together with the previous looting of the led to the collapse of the economy in the 14th century. And the population collapsed by half. You had the Black Death. You had a horrible dark age. And when Lynn says today that the only comparison of what we face today is the 14th century, I mean, it's quite worthwhile to look at this period. You had superstition. The evil Barbara Tuchman writes The Distant Mirror. She describes there how it looked. You had a total collapse of agriculture, production, trade. You had schismatic fights in the church, the flagellants, witch burning. But especially because we are today again confronted with the danger of the new dark age, it is extremely important and fascinating to study the emergence of the Italian Golden Renaissance, of which the Council of Florence in 1439 was the absolute high point and the most beautiful celebration of humankind. The Council of Florence was the gathering of all leading thinkers of nearly all fields of science and art of that time. The Council was able to create unity of the church and to overcome the schism with the Eastern Church on the highest level. Nicolaus of Cus, who was the greatest thinker of his time, who is not only the founder of the modern nation state and modern natural science, was the most crucial influence in the preparatory proceedings. At the Council of Basel in 1433, he wrote the Concordantia Catholica, which represented an absolute breakthrough in state theory. It takes Dante's approach of demonarchia further by introducing the decisive step, the representative system. that the governed and the governing have a reciprocal legal relationship, and that the governed have the right to choose in a secret election. And Nicolaus developed a very sophisticated a secret election system against vote fraud. You have the right to select your representative, and that these representatives then represent the interest of the governed towards the government. But they also have the commitment and duty to the common good of the state. On the other side, the government is responsible for the well-being of all citizens, and it mediates its requirements through these representatives, who are accountable to the people. Now, this is the most precious idea, and the American Constitution is exactly that, because both the government and the citizens are involved, and it's the only way of all the political systems where the individual can participate in self-government through this representative system. It's the only guarantee for individual freedom. Now, this is very important because people, you know, are not conscious, and those people who are not voting, you know, they go back to feudalism by not asserting their right in doing this. Nicolaus of Cusa was also the father of the idea of human rights in practice, the ideas which are in the American Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. But he was the one who resolved this question of the one and the many, how to have unity of the world by having sovereignty of the states at the same time, both for the secular state as well as for the church. He said that concordance in the macrocosm, in the world at large, is only possible through the maximum development of all microcosms. Each nation must not only fully develop, but it must also contribute to the best development of all other nations, not in the sense of an agreement on the least common denominator, but where each microcosm, each nation, contributes like in a contrapuntal fugue in a joint task of perfection, which represents the basic continuity underlying them all. So his famous coincidentia oppositorum is not some Aristotelian construction, but it is a way of bringing the political order, concordantia, into cohesion with the order of creation, whose change is characterized by perfection caused by man replicating God the Creator. Nicolaus, who in Basel was still on the side of the conciliar movement, which was for the church the equivalent of the phenomena of national kings in the church, despite the fact that he absolutely upheld the idea of the independence of the national churches and the sovereignty of the state, Nicolaus recognized that the unity was only possible when there was a higher ordering principle towards which the parts were oriented. So he changed to the side of the papacy while working on an epistemological method, both for finding scientific truth as well as for the ecumenical basis for peace, both in a unified church as well as among the religions. This method, for the first time, was fully represented in the Docta Ignorantia, written in the 3.5 months he spent on a ship coming back from Constantinople to Venice, where he developed the method of learned ignorance. It's what the mother of this Belgian children referred to. Be like children, ask many questions, form hypotheses, don't come to quick answers, generate new hypotheses. In Constantinople, Nicolaus had found the original documents which proved that the famous filioque debate at the council already was an integral part of the credos of the creeds of earlier councils of Constantinople and Nicaea, as well as in the writings of St. Basil. Now, since all of these texts originated from the time before the schism of the church, the Greek patriarchs could be convinced at the Council of Florence that the filioque was not a later addition, and therefore there was no theological basis for the split. His documents were used at the council, and all the patriarchs and officials of the church signed, including Isidore of Kiev. So the unification of the Eastern and the Western Church succeeded. The Council of Florence was the high point of the Renaissance and the watershed of modern history, not only because of the filioque, the idea that the Holy Spirit or Logos emanates equally from the Father and the Son, but also because of the reaffirmation of the idea of Imago Dei, man in the image of God. Nicolaus saw man as imago Dei viva, as the living image of God, and being capable of capax Dei, of participating in God, when man imitates God's most noble aspect, his existence as the creator, through the creative reason. While these ideas existed in Christianity before, only for the upper classes, they were political reality. So the Renaissance, the idea of universal education, which had been started before by the Brotherhood of the Common Life and other teaching orders, they became political real. With the Renaissance, the nation-state republic, a state which is committed to scientific progress for the common good as a mandate, and the idea of the intelligibility of the laws of the universe through the development of the divine spark of reason, Imago Dei and Capax Dei. Now, Nicolaus was quite correct when in the introduction of Concordantia Catholica he wrote that this represented a new epoch of mankind. Now, Nicolaus also developed a scientific method which was absolutely the essence of why this represented such a leap forward. In De Ludo Globi, in the globe game, he wrote that the soul, the human soul, was the place on earth which creates new arts and sciences. That it is the human soul which invents the sciences, arithmetic, geometry, music, astronomy, and in doing so, she experiences that they are folded in her power. Because the sciences have been created by man and have been developed, and because they are eternal and always remain in the same way, therefore the soul can see that she also is eternal and really always remains, the immortality of the soul. Because these mathematical sciences are only in her and folded in her power, so much so that they would not exist if she did not do so. Now, this was against Occam, who had just said there is no individual soul, and Averroes, and especially later Pomponazzi, the evil Venetian agent, zeroed in on this point. Nicolaus says that the lawfulness of the microcosm, the human mind, the soul, and the macrocosm, and the laws of the physical universe are the same. That the microcosm contains in principle everything contained in the macrocosm. That each microcosm, each human soul, recapitulates the evolution of the entire macrocosm, the entire universe, up to that point. Now, Cusanus' microcosm is the idea of the monad of Leibniz, of which we will hear later. How does the laws of this monad look like? One can approximate this if one looks at the conceptual breakthrough Nicolaus made. Nicolaus had a new idea for the solution of the old problem of the quadrature of the circle. by creating the possibility of a new mathematical notion, which only 300 years later would be realized. Nicolaus was completely conscious what he did. He wrote of the novas ars, the new art, and ars ad hoc incognita, an art which up to this point was unknown. The goal of his mathematical writings was to demonstrate the power of the art of coincidentia, which enables the mind to discover the hidden in every area. My main aim is to develop out of the coincidence of opposites the perfection of mathematics, to find that higher order which previously did not exist. It is the first time that there was a thought in mathematics on the level of the infinitesimal, which later became so crucial with Leibniz and others. Nicolaus wrote in De Berillo, "You should also know that among those who are searching for the truth, I have found one more who was in error, namely Plato, because he is saying that one could look at the circle from the standpoint of the name or definition, or the drawing of the mental notions, and that with all of these views, one could not have caught the nature of the circle. Its nature or essence, which would be free of everything contradictorial, simple and eternal, would only be visible with the aid of reason," so said Plato in the seventh letter. "But neither he nor another one I have read considered what I have written in the fourth preparatory remark. If he would have thought deeply, then he would have found that our mind, which has created the mathematical objects, that which he can create, has in himself more truthful and more real than it is outside himself. And likewise, it is within the circle, with the line, with the triangle, but also with our notion of numbers, short with everything which has its origin in the human mind and which is not nature. Therefore, Plato has not thought well when he correctly abstracts the mathematical objects from the sensuous realm and sees them with more truth in the mind, if he believes, therefore, that these would have, even above reason, a different and even more real being. And if Pythagoras and all the others would have reflected well, then they would have seen clearly that the world of mathematics, of mathematical notions and numbers, which are created by our mind, and such are of the kind in which we create our notions, cannot be substances or principles of sensuous objects, but only of mental objects, whose creator we are." Now, this is important because what Nicolaus therefore here refers to is the subjectivity of the cognitive process. Only if man applies the laws of his own mind can he grasp mathematics. There is no mathematics already existing outside of his mind. But this grasping occurs through construction. The mathematical objects are created by the mind. This new conception of mathematics has in many ways consequences. In Demente he writes, "Man relates to the mathematics as God relates to his creatures. Therefore, mathematics is never finished, but always in need of a constructive development perfection." Now, the roots of modern science you can trace back to Plato's Academy. But modern science as such began with Nicolaus of Cus and his breakthrough in mathematical science with the application of Plato's Parmenides principle to effect a correction of the Archimedes effort of the quadrature of the circle. The attempt to construct a practical estimate of the number pi, which represents an estimated ratio of the length of the perimeter of the circle to that of the circle's diameter. He developed the proof that there exists a class of magnitudes in geometry which cannot be rendered congruent with rational numbers in commensurable magnitudes, such as, for example, the hypotenuse of a right triangle. We can place the incommensurables between two magnitudes which are congruent with rational numbers or rational number orderings, showing that these incommensurables is less than the one of this pair but greater than the other. This was the method used by Eudoxus, the method of exhaustion. By this method, the arithmetic value of pi can be measured to any necessary precision for such purposes as carpentry, plumbing, and so forth. Can it therefore be assumed that the series of polygons 2n converges upon the identity with the circular perimeter? In other words, that if you add sides to the polygon, that eventually you will reach the circle. Nicolaus says, absolutely not. The polygon and the circular perimeter are of a different species. At this point, Nicolaus makes the discovery that sets into motion the development of modern science. He insisted that the construction proved that the circular perimeter is of a higher species than the polygon. Earlier, Plato's Academy had shown that measurable magnitudes were divided into two species, rational numbers and incommensurables. And this remained so until Kusa showed that the incommensurables were divided into two mutually exclusive species. The first one is what we call algebraic magnitudes today, especially since the work of Leibniz and Bernoullis in the late 1690s. And the second, higher species discovered by Kusa are called non-algebraic, or what we commonly call the transcendental numbers today. Later, Cantor added the fourth species of magnitudes, the higher transphites or the alephs. So we have four species of magnitudes: the rational, the algebraic, the transcendental, the higher transfinite species, each of them having an increasing power, each being separated from its successor through a gap, such that the higher cannot be accessed formally from the predecessor, but the lower can be accessed from the higher. This gap in upward succession is termed a logical discontinuity or singularity. In order to grasp this gap, one has mentally to replicate the original act of discovery, and this is very essential to recognize the devilish effect of the radical empiricist, whose aim it is exactly to destroy the essential faculty of the mind to make that gap. Now, the implication of Kusa's discovery is that the set of interdependent formal axioms and postulates of the so-called Euclidean geometry was superseded by the adoption of circular action as such in place of the so-called Euclidean axiomatic definitions of points and lines, and that we must abandon the notion of unbounded space-time and accept the notion of a bounded physical space-time, a tradition which then led from Nicolaus of Cusa to Pacioli, Leonardo, Kepler. Once we had adopted Cusa's point of view of the realm of transcendentals, all arithmetic and algebraic realms were accessible. One can always reach the lower, the more primitive form from the higher. Now, this all comes from Nicolaus's Christian law of evolution. Nicolaus already differentiated between anorganic matter, living matter, animals, man, and God, and said that each species can only fully realize its potential when it participates already in one point in the next higher species. So the animal only is fully animal when it is human, at least in one point. And who has a cat would not agree. Man, on the other side, is only fully man when he participates in God. And that point of participation in the next higher species is exactly that singularity which I described before in terms of mathematics. One cannot reach the higher in a deductive way. By being fully bestial, you will never become human. Only if you are what Nicolaus calls being pulled aloft, emporgerissen, that you can reach that. Now, it has been demonstrated many times in human history that this is real, that this leap of discovery does occur, because it always brings mankind new valid principles. In Plato's theory, each of these leaps corresponds to the ability of the human mind to form an adequate hypothesis. And the common principle which generates change between these different hypotheses is called the higher hypothesis. And the higher subsuming principle of all of these are common subject to it, is the hypothesis of the higher hypothesis. This is what the opponents of Plato, Cusa, Leibniz try to destroy. This is the Aristotelian tradition of Sarpi, Galileo, Newton, Maupertuis, Euler, Lagrange, Russell, who deny that such a singularity exists. And they came up with the idea of an infinite series. Now, Venice, in the time of the Renaissance, immediately perceived the Council of Florence and the ideas of the Renaissance as its mortal threat to the most vital interest of the oligarchical financial power. And all of the European history from 1440 to the present have been characterized by an effort of Venice and its allies to destroy the modern nation state and the science and culture associated with the Renaissance. It was not easy because the Renaissance and the new social institutions proved to be a superior conception to the oligarchical model. what occurred that with these reforms, the power of the household zoomed upward per capita and square kilometer. The health and the education of the people became better, and nowhere was this more clearly seen than through the reforms of Louis XI of France, where the income of the population doubled in the time of his reign. So with the Renaissance, the genie was out of the bottle. In the tradition of the brotherhood of the common life and the Renaissance conception of man, the ratio of educated people, of literate people, became larger. And therefore, the intellectual precondition of the population to participate in scientific and cultural progress changed dramatically. The Renaissance and the nation state were such powerful ideas that they could not be destroyed through a frontal attack. And nearly everything what went wrong in European history ever since was the result of the efforts of Venice to destroy the tremendous cultural optimism and trust in the creative powers of man from the inside by subverting this method, and therefore the thinking of the scientists and their institutions. Up to the present day, the most powerful enemy of the conceptions of the Renaissance, of which the sovereign nation state oriented towards the common good of the population is the political expression, was the Enlightenment, which really blossomed in the 18th century, but which had its roots in Aristotle and with the brood of the radicalized Aristotelian Occam. The Enlightenment was the war by the Venetian oligarchy to conquer the soul of the people after they were freed from the Renaissance and make them slaves and serfs again by making them slaves of their own sensuous perception and sensuous desires. As we will see, it is the ideas of the Enlightenment which control practically all aspects of popular opinion today. You don't believe this? Well, did you used to think that the Enlightenment was a positive development until recently? That it somehow represented progress in overcoming superstition and narrowness of religious belief? If you ever entertained such an idea, you were the victim of the oligarchical war for the souls of the people. And the souls is what they were after. When it was Cusa who said that the soul is the place where all the sciences and arts originate, Pietro Pomponazzi, professor at the Venetian-controlled University of Padua in the 16th century, revived Aristotle. And since Aristotle insists that there is no realm of our intellect which is not determined by matter, Pomponazzi said, the consequence is that when the body dies, there is no soul left. And since the soul has no material existence, it does not exist. It was the most blatant attack on the cognitive capacity of man, on of creative reason, celebrated by the Renaissance. Pomponazzi was the teacher of Cardinal Gasparo Contarini, 1483 to 1542, who played the crucial role in supporting the spirituali who joined Luther and the Calvinists during the Reformation, as well as supporting the Counter-Reformation, and all according to the principle of divide and conquer. And he finally was instrumental in the convocation of the Council of Trent, where all the writings of the Renaissance Pope, Enea Piccolomini, were put on the index. In the beginning of the 16th century, the Franciscan monk and agent of the Venetian Secret Service, Francesco Sorsi, played an important role at the court of Henry VIII in the split of the Anglican Church from Rome, an important element in the decision of the Venetian oligarchy to shift the center of power from Venice to Northern Europe, especially Netherlands and England. At the beginning of the 17th century, Paolo Sarpi and his pupil Galileo Galilei launched a major operation to contain Kepler and his groundbreaking discoveries. Kepler had sent his book Mystericum Cosmographicum, and Sarpi and Galileo made a tremendous effort to usurp and plagiarize and falsify Kepler's work. In the 18th century, the Venetian Antonio Conti and Gian Maria Ortis continued that history of scientific fraud and subversion by organizing the campaign Newton versus Leibniz and the lie that Newton would have been the inventor of the calculus and Leibniz would have stolen it, a myth which is still repeated in the textbooks today. Conti, who was a Venetian nobleman, deployed the most extensive campaign to combat the influence of Leibniz. He organized a network in Paris around the philosopher Malebranche and his followers later on. He was close to Fontenelle, the secretary of the French Academy of Sciences, and he organized systematic visits of French scientists to London to recruit them to the English Royal Society and turn them into Anglophile agents. The way to imagine that is like what Soros is doing today with the Russian scientists, is what Conti did then. He picked Newton in an attempt to contain the influence of Leibniz, what Sarpi had done a century earlier with Galileo against Kepler. Conti, without any scruple, hyped up Newton against Leibniz by, you know, reading letters to him, making him mad against Leibniz, and at the same time worked with the Royal Society in a campaign to accuse Leibniz of stealing Newton's calculus. Conti spent from 1715 to 1718 in London and then went back to France to build a pro-Newton campaign on the continent, especially in France and Italy, because Leibniz's popularity on the continent, especially in Germany, was so great that it took very elaborated operations involving entire divisions of paid agents who would slander Leibniz and water down his philosophies by synthesizing them. Now, why was the freak out against Leibniz so extraordinary? Well, the Venetian oligarchy was absolutely aware of the relation of the metaphysical conceptions of the universe and its relation to state theory, i.e. the political system. For them, the ultimate threat was the Renaissance conception of man, the nation-state as developed by Cusanus, the concept of evolution of a non-entropic universe. And they thought they had combated all of this. Now, Leibniz seemed to revive all of this on a much more elaborated basis. Leibniz, who was like the inventor of physical economy, he gave a new definition to this, what is the source of wealth in the economy, namely that it is the productive powers of the creative mind. He pushed the idea of technological progress as that which increases these powers. Now just think how much Leibniz's work meant for Lin's own discoveries of physical economy as the yardstick of relative potential population density, which, by the way, is a true example of what the least action principle implies, namely, you know, that it involves the seed of all the leaps and gaps to be overcome in the future. Leibniz, who also was involved in an enormous amount of diplomatic initiatives, who had proposals for the infrastructure of all of Eurasia, cooperation with China, with Russia, with Peter the Great. Now, from the standpoint of the oligarchy, a mind like Leibniz represented a complete catastrophe. So they went into a super deployment for nearly one century to counter this. The way to imagine this is how the oligarchy today reacted to Lenin. Think of all the many operations in all so many countries. How many $5 agents, 10 pound agents, 5 Finnish agents have, you know, in the last 30 years been deployed? I mean, that's what occurred against Leibniz. Now again, Conti was instrumental, together with the Royal Society, to first build up Newton. The main interest in doing so was to maintain the oligarchical state theory, which from the mid of the 18th century on was called Newtonian state theory, or later hedonistic calculus by Jeremy Bentham. All of this goes back to Thomas Hobbes and his mechanistic notion of society, the idea of kinematic interaction of isolated particles. Hobbes and his successors such as John Locke, Bernard de Mandeville, Montesquieu, Voltaire, Pierre-Louis Maupertuis, Jean-Maria Ortiz, Adam Smith, Jeremy Bentham, James and John Stuart Mill. When Conti was the key organizer in the first phase of Newton versus Leibniz campaign, Voltaire was the organizer in the second phase. And I must say, in having read a lot of what Voltaire wrote and about him, I have come to the conclusion that there was hardly ever a more disgusting, more degenerate, more low-life than Voltaire, and a more absolutely despicable tool of the oligarchs. And it is very interesting to reflect that the Frankfurt School basically praised the Enlightenment and Voltaire as one of the great heroes. Modern Marxism, in Germany, you have Club Voltaires practically in every city. And you know, it really is very interesting. Voltaire was born on the 21st of November in 1694 in Paris as a son of an attorney. His teacher was a certain Abbé de Châteauneuf, the last lover of the famous courtesan Ninon de Lanchet, who introduced him early into paganism and the skepticism of Montaigne. And the young Voltaire soon started to write plays. He got a secret manuscript circulating among the oligarchs at that time that religion is only a device used by the rulers to keep the ruled in order and awe. Now, he was such a spoiled brat that he very early got into trouble with the authorities, which at that point was Louis the 15th, who was a more anti-Venetian king, so that Voltaire in May 1726 had to flee to England, and there he was picked up immediately by the British elite. And he became completely enthusiastic about England. He was influenced by Mandeville, the one who had written that man is evil by nature and that individual vice leads to social good. For example, private prostitution leads to public chastity. Therefore, it is good. If all the people would be moral, lawyers would have nothing to eat. So therefore, it's good that people are bad because it leads to all these beautiful things. So Mandeville was regarded as a cynical materialist, but Voltaire totally agreed with him on the benefits of luxury And Voltaire, by the way, remained a financial speculator all his life. Voltaire said, I love luxury, even a soft life, all the pleasures in the arts, in their variety, the cleanliness, the taste, and the ornaments. He later would write against Rousseau. Now, Mandeville influenced Voltaire, as I said, but he was also impressed by Milton and the idea that Satan was the real hero of Paradise Lost. Voltaire was immediately integrated into the Royal Society. He studied Newton, praised Locke as the first who had made a realistic study of the human mind. And soon he would write, how I love the English, he wrote in a letter to Madame de Defont. Soon he would write his Lettres sur les Anglais, the letters about the English. And he and other representatives of the French Enlightenment became the crucial ones to organize Anglophilia on the continent. He was also influenced by Montesquieu, and he is again one of the key figures of the Enlightenment. People, for some reason, think was a positive figure. He wrote The Spirit of the Laws in 1748, and this was regarded as the greatest intellectual production of the age. It was a naked defense of feudalism, which totally reduced the role of the individual in history and represents the foundation of sociology today. He again said that what counts is the role of the climate and the soil, and which differentiates people. For example, because of the difference in climate, women in the South should be slaves while they should not be slaves in the North. He denied universal truths and laws and had massive influence on Frederick the Great, Catherine the Great, and so forth. When Voltaire went back to France, he began to write La Pucelle d'Orléans, the Maiden of Orléans, about which I will speak a little bit later. He also wrote the play Zaire, and became the most celebrated poet, so-called, of France. This, however, was even by Rousseau, who was living in Brussels at the time in exile, trivial and flat, an odious melange of piety and libertinage. From 1733 to 33, he would work out with his future victim Maupertuis a campaign how to use Newton on the continent, and he did that together with his lover, Madame Emilie du Châtelet. How to spread lies about the so-called liberties and rights in England, and how to stir up revolts against Louis XV and the church. He praised Locke that by tracing all knowledge to sensation, and he welcomed Locke's idea that matter may be able to think, like your digital computers or so. So after his Lettres Philosophiques were published, again he had to flee because they were blasphemous, and all his books got burned. And then the women of the nobility, titled women, attained his pardon. The pardon was withdrawn, and Voltaire traveled from chateau to chateau, from castle to castle, welcomed by the nobles. By that time, the documents of La Pucelle had circulated, becoming the laughing stock of the nobility. He wrote the Traité de Métaphysique, which was the idea of a visitor coming to Earth from Jupiter, who lands in Africa and comes to the conclusion that man is an animal with black skin and woolly hair. And man is therefore composed of completely different species and has not one ancestor. Now here you have a racist, if you ever want one, and the Afro-Americans better look at this Enlightenment and not put the Renaissance people in one pot with these creeps. He also wrote Mahomet in 1742, which was a cynical satire against Christianity and portrayed Mohammed as a conscious deceiver, for whom who foists his new religion upon a credulous people and uses their faith only to spur wars for his own advantage. When Voltaire was 42 years old, he got the first letter of the Crown Prince Frederick from Prussia, whom Voltaire called great, so you can imagine. And this was a meeting of the minds of the worst kind. Now, Frederick, in his very early youth, was spoiled, maybe through the influence of two young officers, Captain von Katte and Lieutenant Keith. And all the books write that they had a suspicious intimacy. Now, his sister, Wilhelmine, said that Frederick was destroyed and all of his religious belief through these young two guys, which infuriated his father, Friedrich Wilhelm I, that he had such an effeminated son. So at a certain point, Frederick even wanted to flee to England with them, whereupon the father executed Katte and made Frederick watch. Now, Frederick grew up as a cynical materialist and determinist. He regarded himself as the pupil of Voltaire, and basically, when he became king later on, however, despite keeping this liberal image, became a true tyrant and despot. His image of man was the following. He said, "Nature naturally produces thieves, the envious, forgers, murderers. They cover the face of the earth, and without laws which represses vice, each individual would abandon himself. Men are naturally inclined to evil, and they are good only in proportion to the extent that education and experience have modified their impetuosity." Naturally, he praised the English as the model. When one of the school inspectors, Sulzer, opposed him and said, "No, man is good," he said, "You do not know this damn race." And he thought that man could only be checked by fear of police. Therefore, it was the duty of the first servant of the state, naturally himself, to organize the defense and offensive system to do to others what they are planning to do to you. This is like a Dallas and Dynasty soap operas. Now, having an army and the police, Frederick thought it was not necessary to have religion because you could manage. He agreed in a pro forma marriage with Elisabeth von Brunswick-Bevern, but he preferred the presence of handsome youth with whom he often went up to his room after dinner for long periods of time. Now, Frederick made major efforts to pull Voltaire to his court, and finally succeeded, and they targeted the Berlin Academy of Sciences, which had been founded by Leibniz under Frederick I in 1701, and they tried to stamp out all influence of Leibniz, and with the help of Voltaire made Berlin the absolute center of British agents, liberals, and free thinkers, and paganists of Europe. There was a complete and total counteroffensive by the Enlightenment. And hardly you ever had seen such a collection of agentry, degeneracy, and Satanists. Among the people whom they called to Berlin were Euler, a Swiss mathematician, and the famous Maupertuis, who became the president of the Academy on the advice of Voltaire. Now, one of the first operations by the Academy under Maupertuis was the attack on Leibniz's monadology. And they made it a subject of a contest in 1747, eliciting pro and contra monadology papers. Now, Leibniz's notion of the monads is key to his conception of the pre-established harmony. For Leibniz, the monads are indivisible, and they have souls, and they do not act towards each other directly, but they are so tuned towards each other by God that what happens inside one monad immediately affects all others. It's the old idea of Parmenides. The many must be subsumed by a one, or the many do not exist. Euler instead believed with Newton that the only thing real were atoms, passive and hard corpuscles, which move against each other, exactly the same primitive mechanistic point of view like Newton, but also really like Descartes, who, despite supposed difficulties between the so-called dogmatic Descartes, who thought that he needed no experiments to prove his deductive assumptions, and Newton, who thought that hypothesis was not necessary. So Descartes said, "For I openly acknowledge that I recognize no other substance of corporeal things than that they are, in every way, omnimode divisible, formable and movable, with the geometers denote as quantity, and take as the subject of their proofs, that I note in it not only those divisions, forms and motions, and recognize nothing in them as real, which is not clearly derived from those general concepts in whose truth one cannot doubt, so that it can be demonstrated mathematically as valid. Then now in this way, all natural phenomena can be explained. Thus, I hold other principles of natural philosophy neither as admissible nor as desirable." Now, Euler was not less mechanistic. In his conception against Leibniz's concept of active substance, he said, "We perceive from this furthermore that such a force which shall be directed at an endless change of the state of body directly contradicts the essence of the body and can in no way and manner be appropriate to the same. For since two contradictory things cannot exist at the same time, thus also a body in its state cannot abide together with one force and be endowed with another force to change its state. It is thus a manifest error when some of these modern philosophers would ascribe to bodies such moving or active forces, and without consideration look at some of these forces even as self-subsisting beings. Thus is it set forth now as clear as day, that such forces occur only in the imagination and cannot possibly exist with the essence of the body." Now, it becomes very clear that Euler misunderstood Leibniz's conception of the monad and took it simply as an atom or a point. According to this, God, who Leibniz had called a monad, would be nothing than a point. Now, Leibniz had claimed that the monads are indivisible, and Euler found a very simple argument against it. He said that it was an old problem if a material body could be divided infinitely or not. This is obviously a question which takes you beyond sensuous experience, because, you know, once you go into the infinite small, you cannot really have a sensuous experience about it. But Euler had no such problem. He claimed that the geometrical body is only the abstraction of the material one, and therefore, according to Euclid, the geometrical body is infinitely divisible. Therefore, this must be the case with a materialism, with the material body. So all this was a silly syllogism, and it was so stupid that many colleagues told Euler that he completely failed to understand Leibniz. Euler, despite the fact that he was one of the directors of the academy and conducted the contest, couldn't help himself to intervene even before the selection was made by publishing an anonymous brochure in which he attacked the theory of the monads and presented his own view as on the true nature of bodies. Then Euler was one of the judges in the contest and gave the piece, the prize, to a very weak paper of one of the enemies of the monads, to a guy called Giusti, who later was deployed against Süßmilch, a proponent of population growth, being in cohesion, being the essence of economic prosperity, in cohesion with the Book of Genesis, again an idea picked up by Lynn later. Euler played such a blatant role in this that both friends and enemies agreed on his complete incompetence. Even the Newtonian D'Alembert wrote to Lagrange how incredible it was that Euler would reveal such an inferior metaphysical knowledge and write such platitudes and absurd things. And Euler's friend, Daniel Bernoulli, the son of the old Bernoulli and collaborator of Leibniz, advised Euler, he said, "You should not deal with such matters. From you, one only expects sublime things, and it is not possible to be excellent in those for you." Indeed, Euler made a fool of himself, and except that he was a paid puppet of Frederick, he would have been discredited as a scientist at that point. But for Leibniz, the characteristic of the monad was exactly what the microcosm was for Nicolaus of Cusa. It is a universality, a minimum in which implicitly the maximum is represented. Since the creative mind of the individual is a monad, it has the non-entropic character of making creative discoveries, which are expressed in the form of scientific and technological progress, and that again has the capacity to increase the population density on the planet, and therefore it does exist. The monad is therefore a reflection of the universe as a whole and the creator. The monad is the image of the living God of Cusa. Now, concerning Euler's argument of infinite divisibility of bodies as a subfeature of extension, Plato already had dealt with this problem in the Parmenides dialogue by showing that the method of simple extension cannot define substance. Not extension, but change is the process, in the process of extension, is the characteristic of the monad. It is the same problem of Cusa's quadrature of the circle. It is not bad infinity of adding endless amounts of new sides to the polygon. It is the actual infinity of making a qualitative leap into a new species. It is the creative power discovering new ideas, leading to a change in what is valid knowledge by overthrowing an entire set of assumptions through discovery of new and valid principles of natural law, leading to an increase in man's efficiency over nature. Euler, from his mechanistic point of view, then attacked Leibniz's notion of analysis situs by saying, "The locus is therefore something which does not depend on the bodies and is equally not a notion of the understanding. And what reality it possesses outside of that, I don't dare to determine." The absurd thing was that Euler was convinced in all of that that he defended, in his own view, religion in the sense of Newton's God, who had to come from time to time to wind up the entropic universe. He claimed that Leibniz's conception, where the power of motion and non-entropic change lies in the monads themselves, leads to atheism. In 1747, he published anonymously a text saying that the divine revelation, saving the divine revelation against the arguments of the free spirits. The next chapter in the campaign against Leibniz turned out to be a complete boomerang, showing the absolute scientific absurdity and personal degeneracy of the entire Enlightenment clique, from Frederick to Voltaire, Maupertuis and Euler. It turned out to be a complete farce. It concerned the fight around Leibniz's principle of least action. Euler was all the time convinced that he was the best mathematician, and therefore he should be the president of the academy. But Frederick had preferred Maupertuis on advice of Voltaire, since for him Euler was too pedestrian. He was a Swiss, German-speaking fundamentalist. Now, Maupertuis, on the other side, was a radical French Enlightenment figure. He had the French wit, the bel esprit, the Frederick liked so much in his company. Maupertuis was not really a scientist. His claim to fame was that he participated in an expedition to the North Pole, which discovered that the Earth was flattened on both poles. Now, from that time, Maupertuis had the feeling that he could not breathe if not the entire world would look and adore him. For 6 months, his trip to the North Pole was the talk of Paris. And Maupertuis did everything to remind everyone that he was the one who had made the trip to the pole. He had himself painted in reindeer fur, the left hand on a flattened globe and the right hand showing the direction of science. Now, he had brought 2 Lapland girls, naturally without the permission of the parents, and showed them around in Paris as a trophy. Then he went to places in Paris in the winter, and he would suddenly grab some snow from the floor and look at it thoughtfully. And then people would say, oh, he must be comparing it with the snow from the North Pole. Naturally, he had an African servant, and his vanity was just limitless, and he wanted to be the number one everywhere. He was, at the same time, arrogant and sniping, and soon, naturally, all his colleagues were against him. In Berlin, for example, he treated Euler as completely inferior. After all, it was he, Maupertuis, who had made Newton totally famous in France. So, but obviously he had more bel esprit and imagination than scientific knowledge. And this extreme vanity and lack of scientific judgment turned out to be a fatal mixture. When D'Alembert in 1743 wrote his Traité de Dynamique œuvre, where he called that all mechanical principles must be expressed immediately in a mathematical differential equation, Maupertuis felt very competitive. So finally, he grabbed the least action principle of Leibniz and said, I have discovered the law of the universe. For example, light, if forced through mirrors and breaking surfaces like water, makes detours. And since always seeks the route which requires the least time. Now, Maupertuis believed with Newton that light was just very fast moving particles. And out of this, Maupertuis concluded that for each change in nature, the magnitude of the used action is the most little as possible. Now, since this is not even true for so-called pure mechanical actions, Maupertuis did not even attempt a proof. Helmholtz, another mechanic guy later, said at least he was lucky in guessing the truth. He was wrong on that too, but Maupertuis basically said, therefore, it cannot be a coincidence that the necessary action would always be the smallest. It had to be the intended austerity measure of a smart creator. So in 1749, he declared proudly that he had found the undebatable proof that this law of least action existed, and it would be so worthy of the supreme being that the movements of the animals and the growth of the plants and the orbits of the planets would all be the necessary consequence. Now, why God needed this budget-cutting approach, he did not say. And why God, of all people, should have a Maastricht mentality in creating the universe, reflecting his dignity, Maupertuis did not explain. But, you know, Leibniz obviously had said nothing of that sort. He was very careful and said that the right question is always that which poses the right next higher hypothesis, which is what the least action principle represents, while the mechanists are always very fast to reduce something to a new formula before even the new dimension of the problem has been sought out. Now, that was the setting in which the famous Koenig's affair occurred. Now, in 1750, Koenig, who was a Swiss mathematician who lived in Holland at the court of a not less influential position than Maupertuis, visited him in Berlin. And he presented Maupertuis his paper, which contained a criticism of Maupertuis' document of the least action principle. Koenig wanted to be fair and show it to Maupertuis before he published it. But Maupertuis, in a fit of arrogance, refused to read it and said, "Do with it what you please." And since Maupertuis refused to discuss the matter, Koenig published the matter in March 1751 in the Leipziger Akten. Koenig demonstrated there that the least action principle is not always a minimum, sometimes even a maximum, so that the entire budget-cutting approach of Maupertuis went out of the window, and that the whole matter had been discussed already by Leibniz, who had argued that the least action could be either a minimum or a maximum. And he referenced a quote of a letter by Leibniz to Hermann in 1707. Leibniz said, "Action is not what you think. The consideration of time enters into it. Action is the product of the mass by the space and the velocity, or as the time by this vice versa. I have remarked that in the modification of motion, the action becomes usually a maximum or a minimum. And from this, there might be several propositions of great consequences be reduced. I might serve to determine the curves described by bodies under attraction to one or more centers. I had meant to treat of these things in the second part of my Dynamik, which I suppressed, the reception of the first by prejudice in many quarters having disgusted me." Now, after this article appeared, Maupertuis was beside himself. How much effort had it cost him to convince the world that Leibniz was nothing than a plagiator of the great Newton? And now he, the great Maupertuis, was demasked as a plagiator of Leibniz, and an incompetent one on top of it. The honor of the entire academy was at stake, even the honor of the king. So the academy ordered Koenig to produce the original of the letter of Leibniz, knowing perfectly well that the authentic copy, which had been in the possession of Koenig's friend Henze, whom the Swiss had executed in the meantime, was in the possession of the Swiss authorities, and therefore this letter could not be produced. Maupertuis' reaction was incredibly stupid, and one would have thought that he would have somehow admitted it, but by insisting that the letter was a forgery, he just proved that he was a paid agent. So was Euler, who faithfully wrote an opinion arguing at length why this letter could not be from Leibniz. And here you have the classical example that scientific objectivity, when money is involved, when the academy pays you to write an opinion, is not to be believed. And you know, if you read Greenie scientists today, you have the same thing. Now, there is no question that Euler knew the issue, because he had studied with Johann Bernoulli, a collaborator of Leibniz. He had the famous letter to Hermann was Euler's relative, with whom he had spent 6 years at the academy in St. Petersburg. So there's no question that Euler knew. But at that time, Voltaire decided to strike against Maupertuis because this fraud was even too blatant for this degenerate. Voltaire published a response, "D'un académicien de Berlin à un académicien de Paris," in which he accused Maupertuis of plagiarism, blunder, misuse of office to suppress free discussion, and so forth. And since Frederick was of a mixed mind, on the one hand, he agreed with Euler, with Voltaire, but on the other side, his academy was at stake. So he felt compelled to write an anonymous response, calling Voltaire's letter a malicious, cowardly, and infamous piece, the author a shameless imposture, a concoctor of stupid libels, and so forth. So Voltaire was insulted. Now, Maupertuis just had published at this point letters in which he proposed certain scientific projects. For example, such incredible things like that enough opium enables men to see the future, or that in order to avoid sicknesses, you should just cover the body with an impenetrable paste to prevent sicknesses from coming in, or the vivisection of the brain of living criminals to find out how the mind works, because the individual means nothing, he wrote. Against which Voltaire wrote his famous diatribe, Dr. Acacia, which was published in The Hague, and again Voltaire had to flee because Frederick didn't like it. He quickly stole the poems of Frederick and wrote more diatribes, so forth. This whole affair became the gossip of all palaces in Germany and France. And since most of the nobility were loyal followers of Voltaire, this was the issue of the time. König, the poor mathematician, never recovered. He died soon after in the age of 45. And Voltaire continued his travel from chateau to chateau and was described, for example, by the famous German historian Leopold von Ranke as being the most jealousy-driven, greedy, a guy who always would instigate feuds even among his friends. One of the blackest and most perfidious souls, when he would approach you with calmness, he was for sure plotting. And when he would listen to you friendly, watch out. So in 1753, the Academy under Maupertuis started the next contest, this time to compare Leibniz's system of optimism with Pope's all is good theses. More important, in end of 1758, Voltaire wrote within a few weeks his famous piece Candide against Leibniz. Now, this book was such a scandal that in 1759 it was publicly burned in Geneva, in 62 put on the index by the Vatican. However, 40 editions were published until Voltaire died. It was a vicious attack on Leibniz's thesis of the best of all possible worlds. Candide was a simple-minded fellow, and his teacher, Pangloss, and Voltaire has them, travel and all possible horrors happen to them. For example, in the second chapter, Candide gets captured by Bulgarian soldiers and he gets whipped 4,000 lashes with a whip so that his blood and flesh and muscles are all ripped apart so that he begs to die. I mean, it's gruesome and on like that. So what he wanted to prove is that optimism is nothing but illusion. Even worse, that optimism is an intentional fraud against man to get him unwarned in ever new disasters. And that out of the self-deception of the philosophers becomes the fraud against mankind. It is very interesting that Ernst Bloch, also Frankfurt School, called Candide the first sign of his own principal hope, Prinzip Hoffnung. And naturally, the Frankfurt School, the famous Horkheimer and Adorno, wrote the Dialectics of the Enlightenment, in which they praised this book. Leibniz in the Theodicy had said something completely different, namely that God has chosen the best possible plan in creating the world in which the largest manifold is combined with the highest degree of order, where location, space, and time are used in the best possible way, where the highest efficiency can be accomplished in the simplest way, and where the creatures have the most power, the most knowledge, the most happiness and goodness with the universe, which the universe could possibly contain. Naturally, Leibniz did not mean that the individual man would experience the maximum happiness. Voltaire's method was to pull the sacred into the dirt, take hope and inject cynicism and be witty. If Candide was bad, Voltaire's La Pucelle d'Orléans, the Maid of Orléans, was bad, as bad or worse. The heroic figure of Joan Arc, who saved France in the Hundred Years' War from the occupation of the English, remember the Venetian role in this. Obviously, Voltaire, as a scribbler for the oligarchy, still had a beef with Joan Arc as a positive image of the soul of France. Historically, Jeanne d'Arc is one of the most remarkable figures in history, despite the fact that she was a young girl, a shepherdess, who led a military offensive against the English successfully. She was clearly an extraordinary woman, able to inspire the hearts of the French and giving France back its soul, shaping the entire century of the 15th century. She was burned at the stake in 1431 as a result of agentry and intrigue. And ever since, the Anglo-Saxon literature tried to defame her as a mythical figure or not existing at all. Voltaire, in 1730, at the suggestion of the Duc de Richelieu, began to write La Pucelle, and he finished it when he was 65. Voltaire portrayed Joan in an obscene way, as a silly peasant girl trying to defend her virginity against lascivious monks, and portrayed her religion simply as a farce. The manuscript circulated, and even before it was finished, La Pucelle had become the laughingstock of the entire degenerated nobility of the Enlightenment. When Schiller decided to write Joan of Arc, he proved to be tremendously courageous. He undertook to move an audience with a subject about which the whole world had just rolled on the floor with dirty laughter. The image the entire educated world had of Jeanne d'Arc was that painted by Voltaire. Schiller's work was all the more daring because everybody knows from experience how difficult it is to present a noble and sublime idea after sarcasm and cynicism. You all have experienced that. When the Duke of Weimar heard that Schiller was planning to write the play of Jeanne d'Arc, he wrote to Caroline von Wolzogen, who was Schiller's sister-in-law. Full of horror, I learned that Schiller has written a theater play, La Pucelle d'Orléans. The subject is very scabrous and object of ridicule, which hardly can be avoided, especially among people who know Voltaire's poem practically by heart. But that was exactly the point. Schiller, who had a passionate love for mankind, who was a complete Leibnizian by philosophy, and who had experienced the degeneracy of the enlightened absolute nobility of his time firsthand, could not bear the idea to see the noble image of mankind drawn into the dust. He not only wrote the most beautiful play, Joan of Arc, but in his letters he left no doubt that the Joan of Arc was the person he loved and that she was the most direct expression of his agapic love for mankind. But he also wrote the following poem, which I will read to you first in German and then in English. Das Mädchen von Orléans. Das edle Bild der Menschheit zu verhöhnen. Im tiefsten Staube wälzte dich der Spott. Krieg führt der Witz auf ewig mit dem Schönen. Er glaubt nicht an den Engel und den Gott. Dem Herzen will er seine Schätze rauben. Den Wahn bekriegt er und verletzt den Glauben. Doch wie du selbst aus kindlichem Geschlechte, selbst eine fromme Schäferin wie du, reicht dir die Dichtkunst ihre Götterrechte, schwingt sich mit dir den ewigen Sternen zu. Mit einer Glorie hat sie dich umgeben, dich schuf das Herz, du wirst unsterblich leben. Es liebt die Welt, das Strahlende zu schwärzen und das Erhabene in den Staub zu ziehen. Doch fürchte nicht, es gibt noch schöne Herzen, die für das Hohe, Herrliche entglühen. Den lauten Markt mag Momus unterhalten. Ein edler Sinn liebt edlere Gestalten. The Maid of Orleans. The noble image of mankind to Sully. Contempt doth roll thee in the deepest dust. Wit wageth war eternally on beauty. In angel and in God, he holds no trust. To rob the heart her treasures he intendeth. Illusion he besets, and faith offendeth. Yet, like thyself from childlike generation, a shepherdess like thou of piety, to thee doth poetry extend her godly sanction. To the eternal stars she swings with thee. Within a halo, who doth thee encircle? The heart formed thee, thou wilt lift on immortal. The world doth love the radiant too dirty, and the sublime to track in the dust below. Yet have no fear, there are still hearts of beauty which for the high, the glorious do glow. The noisy market Momus may make mirthful. A nobler mind loves forms which are more noble. This idea of a childlike generation is the sense, in the sense of kind or species, is what the mature Schiller had discovered as the foundation of any truly creative activity, as the only basis for genius. With naive grace, the genius expresses his most sublime and profound thoughts, divine thoughts expressed with the purity of the child. Schiller really expressed a philosophy of childhood in this sense, stressing always the importance to maintain a childlike soul. In the third aesthetical letter, he writes that when destiny has caused a break, a destruction in your development, then you have to find in your maturity back to your childhood, not in going back to the past, but by finding a new ideal of mankind in cohesion with your childhood. He wrote to Goethe, "This second youth in the is the divine youth, and therefore immortal." This means that one can find cohesion. The means how one can find cohesion is poetry. Therefore, the poets are the avant-garde of the new mankind, as were Lull, Dante, and Schiller. This idea of the childlike naivety in poetical work, being the poetical work, Schiller maintained his whole life. Schiller otherwise completely took the wind out of Voltaire's sail, saying that behind his satire was only the poverty of the heart, and that therefore his meager monotony was the result, and that his wit was nothing, had nothing to do with poetry. Voltaire and Schiller in many ways represent the most opposite poles of their century. There is no greater contrast possible. It is a remarkable success that through Schiller, the Voltaire Pucelle totally vanished out of the public memory. When people today think about Joan of Arc, they think about Schiller's Joan of Arc. But practically every book about the Enlightenment admits that otherwise the axioms of thinking of the Enlightenment have taken over nearly all faculties of science and the art up to the present day. Most people think that Montesquieu represented an important step in the evolution of modern democracy. Most mathematicians think that Euler was a great mathematician and that D'Alembert was right, that everything in physics can be put in self-evident mathematical equations. But even more fundamental than that was that the Enlightenment had done to the soul of the people, it simply had stolen it. By first declaring that it did not exist, like Pomponazzi, then they proceeded to eliminate creative reason by pretending to be so liberal, so progressive, so pro-science, they flattened the universe to their mechanistic version. But most important, they took away hope from mankind and replaced it by love of lust. But if you look at Voltaire, Frederick Euler, and Maupertuis, what sad, cynical figures they were. They did not spread science, but they only took away confidence and optimism that the human mind is made in the image of God and capable of creative reason, which enables him to overcome any problem. Unfortunately, the Enlightenment had many bastard offsprings. For example, Kant's critical method, the Frankfurt School, and the deconstructionism of Derrida today. There are many more fascinating stories to be told about the fight in the tradition of Leibniz. There were Lessing and Moses Mendelssohn at the Berlin Academy and their work in the library of Wolfenbüttel. There were many breakthroughs in the German classic who went back to the Greek classics, the Renaissance, who took up the Renaissance and which was turned into an education system by Wilhelm von Humboldt with the idea to make each child potentially a genius by having them learn the entirety of human universal history and the crucial breakthroughs in art and science. And there was the extremely important defense of Leibniz by Emmerich del Fattel, who became the chief advisor of the Count of the King Augustus III of Saxony during the time Prussia attacked it, which was inspired by the British and led to the Seven Years' War. His beautiful book, The Laws of Nation, challenged all the basic axioms of the Venetian-British oligarchy, and it became the most influential book on constitutional questions for the next 125 years and massively influenced the founding fathers of America. It was studied and quoted by Franklin, John Adams, Alexander Hamilton, and many others. The book re-established the absolute necessity of unrestrained national sovereignty and a government based on natural law, also emphasizing the need for government to instruct the people to seek felicity where it can be found, that it is the own perfection of themselves, and to teach them the means of obtaining it. De Fattel said, the first general law that we discover in the very object of the society of nations is that the individual nation is bound to contribute everything in her power to the happiness and perfection of all others. That was, again, exactly the idea of Concordantia Catholica in Leibniz's world development. Now we have come to the turning point, the fundamental branching point, the punctum saliens in history. The global financial system is in a breakdown crisis, and we are looking at a worse collapse than the 14th century. The 600-year epoch, the fight between the nation state and the oligarchical model, coexisted in a symbiotic form. This is coming to an end. If the nation state and the sovereignty are eliminated, we are looking to a new form of barbarism mankind probably never has seen. The alternative is already there. The fact that India, China, Iran, Turkey, the Central Asian republics are working on the Eurasian land bridge, that Germany and France, under conditions of their collapsing economies, are orientating towards the Eurasian land bridge, means that there is hope. If we can convince the US government to adopt the Eurasian land bridge as being in the strategic security interest of the United States, and that the United States must go back to the policy of the founding fathers to support a community of principle among sovereign nation states, then the oligarchism, their evil ideology, the Enlightenment, can be defeated forever, and a new renaissance is within reach. Del Fattel wrote, how happy would mankind be were these amiable prospects of nature everywhere observed. Nations could communicate to each other their products and their knowledge. A profound peace would prevail all over the earth and enrich it with its invaluable fruits. Industry, the sciences, and the arts would be employed in promoting our happiness, no less than in reliving our wants. Violent methods of deciding contests would be no more heard of. All differences would be terminated by moderation, justice, and equity. The world would have the appearance of a large republic. Men would live everywhere like brothers, and each individual be a citizen of the universe. That this idea would be but a delightful dream, yet it flows from the nature and the essence of man. This is the idea of the Ode to the Joy by Schiller, all men become brethren. And it is the idea of the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven. It is the poets and the composers who shape human history. Let us therefore make a solemn commitment that we create a beautiful world with people with a beautiful soul.